Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this last Sunday in November before we get to Advent. Yay! Starts next week. So a few announcements before we get started in worship today. You'll notice I'm the only one up here today. Pastor Eric is taking the day off. Huzzah, right? All right. So, and I want to give a big thank you to all the people who helped out in cooking food and bringing food over for the Thanksgiving meal for Harbor House. We were supposed to only make like 25 meals-ish, but we ended up making more like 45 because of all the food we had, and they gave it all out. So we were really grateful that there was an abundance, and so just thank you for that. And we had all these pies left over from the Kaneo Valley Interfaith Association's Interfaith Thanksgiving service from the night before. So there was also a ton of pie, like so much pie. It was ridiculous. So thank you so much for helping out with that and making that happen last minute. We also have the art auction that started on Thanksgiving Day. The art auction is online, and it goes to support our youth programs and to help some of our kids get to New Orleans next year for the youth gathering. And some of the art is in the narthex if you want to take a look, but the bids start really small. It's like $20 or something, right, for most of them. And the auction goes until Tuesday, so you have until then to make a bid on an art piece, and we will deliver it to you or mail it wherever it needs to go, and we appreciate your support in that. And also, as I said, Advent begins next week, so if you want an Advent devotional, there are copies in the narthex. There are also Advent calendars that you can take home that are all related to the theme we're going to be talking about starting next week, which is how does a weary world rejoice, right? How do we find ways to rejoice? And that'll take us all the way up through the beginning of January. And and if you need it emailed to you, an Advent calendar for those that are watching online, if you would like this, the devotional booklet or the Advent calendar, we can email it to you. So just let us know if you haven't received that yet. I think that's it. Oh, and giving tree, the gifts for the kids are due next Sunday. So make sure you bring those if you signed up to bring a gift. I wanted to make sure I reminded all of you about that. I think that's it. Let us turn to our choir for our call to worship.
I will worship the Lord all the days of my life. I will tell of his glory and will show forth his praise. I will sing and rejoice, for the Lord is my song. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Every week, as we worship together, we have the opportunity to release. To release and to let go of the things that have weighed heavy on our hearts and to admit to the ways that we have not lived as we are called. So in this time of confession, in this time of opening our hearts, let us remember that God is ready to receive it, is eager to offer grace, and hopeful in the possibilities of our lives. Let us pray. You asked for our hands, that you might use them for your purpose. We gave them for a moment, then withdrew them, for the work was hard. You asked for our mouths to speak out against injustice. We gave you a whisper, that we might not be accused. You asked for our eyes to see the pain of poverty. We closed them, for we did not want to see. You asked for our lives, that you might work through each of us. We gave a small part, that we might not get too involved. Lord, forgive our calculated efforts to serve you, only when it feels convenient and easy. Help us to release our complacency, our guilt, fears, and frustrations. Fill us up, O God. Heal our bodies and souls, our minds and hearts, so that we will be freed to serve and love and dream and be. Beloveds, you are beautiful. May you believe this day in the beauty that God sees in each and every one of you. Know that you are forgiven this day and every day, so that with a heart filled up with grace and love, you might be freed and empowered to offer the same gifts to others. Amen. Please rise in body and spirit as we sing our opening hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we are thankful that you are not some God far away, but that you draw near to us. You are beside us in every part of every day. We ask today that you help us see opportunities to be your hands, feet, mouth, and ears in this world. May we seek out opportunities to support each other. May we find ways to study your word together. May we be people who welcome others into a relationship with you. May we find ways to serve you by serving others. We love you and praise you for who you are and how you continue to transform our lives. Amen. You may be seated.
First reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 9. Now in Joppa there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, who heard that Peter was there, sent two men to him with the request, "Please come to us without delay." So Peter got up and went with them, and when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put all of them outside, and then he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, get up." Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for a reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 13. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had reclined again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Now you can be seated, don't worry. Please pray with me. Holy God, we give you thanks for this word, for the word of your people, for the stories of those that have come before us. And God, we pray that whatever it is, you would have our hearts here today, that our hearts would be open to receiving it, that it would touch on the parts of us that, that you know that we need. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. For our last week in our series on seeking God together, we've been doing that for like 12 weeks now, I think. And before we enter into Advent and the preparations for Christmas that begin next week, last but certainly not least, we have this concept of serving, seeking God together through service. We began this series by thinking about how God is within us and about how and why we pray, how to make time, how to make room, and thinking about this more personal and what we might consider to be a more private relationship with God. And then we moved into the more public aspects of faith, sensing and wondering about God's presence all around us, giving thanks together, how we marvel at God's existence, how we confess together and lament together and even celebrate together. And finally, we moved to how our faith and our relationship with God impacts our relationship with others. And vice versa, I would add. How do our relationships with one another impact our faith and our relationship with God, right? It goes both ways. Now, on our journey through life and faith, we are called to support one another, to study the word together, to welcome and make room at our table for all. And it all comes to culminate in this week about serving. Its importance for our own well-being, for the well-being of others, and how the joy that we experience through the love of God comes through in the ways that we serve others, how we serve together, and even when we are being served. We get this ultimate view of service as Jesus kneels at the feet of his friends in our gospel reading today. He's having a meal with them. He knows that the time of his death is very near. His disciples and friends have been on quite the journey with him. Anybody remember when we typically read this story in the church year? Lent, yes, specifically Maundy Thursday, yeah. So Maundy Thursday is when we typically read this story, and we even wash each other's feet if you're so bold and brave, right? So that's when we get to hear this story, but I love that we get to hear it again kind of out of that storyline. The disciples, they need to hear this lesson from Jesus. Not only hear it, but they need to fully experience it. So Jesus washes their feet, and we don't read this part of the passage today, but just a few verses earlier, Peter says, "You'll never wash my feet." No, no, no. Washing the feet was the work of the servants. And not just any servant, but typically a female servant. Right? How dare. A lowly job. Jesus takes on the work of a female servant, making this, in the men's eyes, an even more humiliating act. And within these dynamics of ancient culture, this is the reality. Right? But Jesus doesn't stop. He knows exactly what he is doing. He is changing up the roles. He is acting against their expectations. He is widening the table. He is shifting the systems of power that are at play. He says, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that's what I am. So if I have done this to you, you need to go do it for each other. I need you to kneel at each other's feet. I need you to help dismantle the powers that be. I need you to serve, not by telling others what to do, by standing high and lofty above them, but I need you to get your hands and your feet and your knees dirty. You are equal with one another. with everyone. So switch up the roles. Break the system. That's what Jesus is doing. He's telling them, break the system. Show people by walking a different path, by washing the disciples' feet, Jesus isn't just preparing them for his death. This isn't just one last lesson before Jesus dies. This is saying that we live in a power-hungry world. We live in a world where evil takes the form of one person being valued over another, where hierarchy and money and possessions are more important than the love of neighbor, where you are only welcomed into a community if you have the money to pay into it. Could it be that an act of love and such an act of humility, like washing one another's feet, could begin to push back against the corrosive expectations of the world? Could it be that acts such as these, role reversals like this, could bring us closer to God's dream for humanity? So in our gospel reading, we have Jesus taking on what would typically be the role of a female servant in this time and place. And Peter rejects it, not fully understanding the implications. And then in our reading from Acts, we have Peter performing a miracle, calling Tabitha, yes, a woman, right, to life. And it feels like, okay, these stories just need to be connected. So let's get into Tabitha's story just a little bit. Anybody know what that name means, Tabitha? Anybody? Also Dorcas in Greek, right? But she's a gazelle. It means she's a gazelle. That's what Tabitha means. It's kind of a cool fun fact for the day. But Tabitha is this only woman, the only woman who is explicitly named as a disciple in the New Testament. The only one. She is a woman who, based on her reputation of being known for her good deeds and her giving of alms, it means she has some means. She has a little bit of money, right? She cares for the widows in her community and seemingly forms a family of women around her. And when she dies and Peter arrives after people are like, hey, Peter's in the next town. Let's go get that guy. Maybe he can do something about this, right? After being called upon, this family of widows gathers around Peter and they're like, look what she did. Look at this family she created. Look what she did for us. Now, if we go back to Acts 6, there's a story about the church specifically choosing 7 men to do the work of caring for the widows in Jerusalem. Some people were being left out. People, they wanted to make sure everybody was being cared for. And those individuals would be called deacons, right? We still have deacons in the church today. And we never get such a story about Tabitha receiving a title. She did the work simply because she had the means to do it. Tabitha is a disciple because of the work she is doing, caring for those on the margins. And in this time and place, that happened to be the widows in her community. Her worth and her value, the value of her work, was not determined by her wealth. It was certainly not determined by her gender. It was not determined by her husband, the children she bore, or the food she cooked. Tabitha impacted the lives of a community of women through her compassion and the ways that she cared for them. Maybe not named as an official leader by the official church community, but she was certainly valued as integral in caring for the most vulnerable in her part of the world. Tabitha shows us that when we serve others, we are saying to people, you matter. You are valued. You are important because you are a beloved of God. And Peter goes from arguing, and I'd even go so far as to say rejecting what Jesus was doing, because of how humiliating it was for Jesus to be taking on this role of a female servant, shocked by the absurdity and humiliation. He goes from that to then performing a miracle in order to see a woman serving the church, valued deeply by the people around her, restored to her community. Peter has been on a journey. He's been on a journey to discover what service truly is about. I know that I have experienced similar journeys over and over and over again, whether through personal experience or by witnessing it through the acts of others. And for many years, I volunteered at a church that kind of flipped my expectations of service on its head. I learned there that it was about relationships, relationships, relationships. That's what it was all about. And I remember that one of the pastors that used to work there, he told me a story about their community garden. And they had this little patch of land that was across the street from the church. And it wasn't very big because it was in a city, right? So it's this just like cute little corner lot in the city, in the neighborhood. And one day he's out there in the garden with one of the kids from the neighborhood. And folks in the area, they didn't have a lot of money, and the kids would come by all the time asking for blankets or food or a place to just hang out because they knew that that church, that space, was physically safe for them. They knew that people there cared about them. They knew who they could go to when they needed something or even when they just wanted to just be, right? This one particular kid knew it so well that one time they were working out in the garden together and this car drove by and the kid immediately dropped to the ground because he knew that if he was seen with the pastor hanging out, that some people would not like that very much. Right? It would mean trouble for him. Yet he kept going back to the church anyway. Because the emotional safety of that space was worth the risk. It was worth it because there was love there. It was worth it because he was told, you matter and you are valued and you are important because you are a beloved child of God. Now, this same pastor, he had an office on the second floor of the building with lots of windows. Right? And so he could see quite a bit of the neighborhood around him because there weren't a lot of tall buildings there. And if he saw a drug deal happening across the street, he would throw on his collar, he'd walk down the stairs, out the door, and he'd say, hey, how you doing? A very dangerous act, I might add. He used his title to do good. It wasn't about showing off or making sure people knew who he was, right? He did those things because it was about keeping the neighborhood safe for the kids who knew that the church was a safe space for them, right? It was about finding ways to enter into relationship with people, to make sure that folks were taken care of, that they had heat in the winter, that they had food in the fridge, and they had the support system for not only physical, but for their spiritual and emotional needs. And all it took was for him, was when somebody knocked on the door, all it took was him taking a step outside, opening the door, taking one step, and another, and another, and another, to be with and among people, to show people that he cared about them, that this community, that this congregation cared about them, right? That this was a safe space. And he didn't do it on his own, because if he did it all on his own, that means, well, if we do anything on our own, that means burnout most of the time, right? But it means having a community of people, not just him going out the doors and saying, we care about you, you are valued and you are loved. He wasn't sitting high in his office, just looking down, saying, oh, it will be what it will be. To be in the world with and among people, it means learning and listening and helping and loving. So I learned about a lot about what service meant in those years when I worked there. I learned that there's no one right way and that maybe I don't always have the answer. I learned that some people appreciate it more than others. I learned that I made assumptions about people and that was going to have to change. I learned that trust makes a world of difference, and trust takes time, and again, listening, and stepping outside the door to build relationships with people. I wonder, Have you ever had an experience that changed the way that you think about service? Or is there someone in your life that has kind of made you change the way you think about it? Have you ever been on a journey like Peter's? Are there any people who, like Jesus, shocked you by taking on a role filled with humility? Anyone who, like Tabitha, lived a life filled with compassion and care for others despite little recognition? And what I love about Tabitha is that I can imagine that she empathized with these women, that she understood to a certain degree their experience of being a woman, of the realities of their status in that time and place. So she entered into their world and built a community with them. She chose to be with and among these women. She had the means to fulfill a need that was there, but first she stepped outside the door. And by so doing, created a family. Because it's not about titles and recognition, and it's not about hierarchy, and it's not about wealth and attribution. It is about relationships, and it is about community. It is about being with and among one another, using the resources that we have to shift the systems of power that are at play and to widen our tables. Sometimes that means getting our hands and feet a little bit dirty, and sometimes that means taking a risk, and sometimes it means little to no recognition. So to serve and to kneel at the feet of others, to care for and form family around us, this comes from a deep sense of joy. The joy of knowing that we are beloveds of God. And it is that joy that informs the compassion and the care and the empathy and the kindness that we offer to others. The joy doesn't come from the acts of service, although that is a wonderful natural side effect. But the joy is what inspires to serve others. So where might your joy, where might your deep down in your gut, beautiful, beloved of God joy, where might it be sending you today? Where might you be called to help widen the table, to help build a relationship, and to get your hands and feet just a little bit dirty? Amen.
Thank you.
The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please share a sign of peace with one another. This time in our service, we take a moment to make our offerings for the work God calls us to do in the world. Now let us make a prayer over our offerings. Gracious God, our time, our gifts, and our talents are presented to you. Take these offerings and transform them for your reign on earth. May our lives be a blessing to you and a blessing to others. As we grow, may we learn to trust. As we study, may we share wisdom. As we welcome, may all come near. And as we serve, may people feel your love. Amen. Lord, hear our prayer. Great and mighty God in heaven, holy be your name. God, you are holy, and we thank you for your goodness, your kindness. You are loving and gracious. You are over everything and in everything. Lord, hear our prayer. God, we want to trust you. Help us to see the world that you dream of, a world of wholeness and justice for all creation. Lord, hear our prayer. God, we know that there are many who are hungry in the world and in our own communities. Give us eyes to see how you want us to be a part of your provision in the world. Give us hands that share generously. Lord, hear our prayer. We confess that we are sinners in need of your grace, and we recognize that every day we also encounter people created in your image who may need our forgiveness. So give us the grace to seek your forgiveness and to forgive others. Lord, hear our prayer. God, we pray for protection in the coming week. Lead us and guide us along the right paths. Be with those in places all around the world where there is violence and conflict, especially in Gaza, Iran, and Sudan. Protect and guide them. We especially pray for those newly added to our prayers this week, for Roger Anderson for healing, and for Sherry Groenveld and her family at the recent death of her sister. Lord, hear our prayer. We bring to you all the prayers of our hearts, O God, trusting that you hold them with grace and love. Amen. Siblings in Christ, join in today for a feast which will comfort our souls. Join us in the sacrament, knowing that as we share in this meal at this table together, we grow ever close to God, neighbor, and to ourselves. God, we pray that this feast is one that fills our souls with comfort. May your Holy Spirit bless this bread and cup. May your Spirit bless us as we celebrate at the peaks of life and as we abide in the shadow-filled valleys. May the Spirit bring us the peace that will permeate our hearts, whatever state they are in. And may the Spirit use this time and space to remind us that you are within us and beside us each and every day. And with his friends, Jesus shared his Last Supper before his death, and the group recognized the sacred in their gathering and celebrated their friendship and their community of faith. Jesus took the bread and blessed it, and in his breaking of bread, Jesus yearned for them to remember his teaching, their times together, and to feel his very presence among them. He told them, "Whenever you eat this bread, do it in remembrance of me." And Jesus took the cup and gave thanks. He said, "This cup is a new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this cup, do it for remembrance of me." As we prepare to join together in this meal, let us pray together the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us, remembering with gratitude the many people who have shared this meal and said these words before, those beside us now and the many who will come after. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The meal is ready. All are welcome at this table. Our ushers will guide you forward to receive a wafer. We also have gluten-free. If you need that, please just ask. And then you can receive either wine or grape juice, whichever you prefer, and place your empty cup in one of the baskets off to the side before returning to your seats. Let us eat.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in this simple meal, you have set a feast. Sustain us on the journey, strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us joy-filled and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. Amen. Please rise in body or in spirit to receive a blessing. Go from here, knowing that you do not go alone, that God is with you and God is beside you. So share God's love along the way. Amen. Go in peace serving the Lord. Thanks be to God.